What is up, YouTube? It's your girl, Evelyn, and I am back with the Season 3, Episode 8, Season Finale Recap of Killing Eve. As always, there will be spoilers, so proceed with caution. Villanelle and Carolyn are having their second secret meeting, but this time in the upper levels of the iconic Royal Albert Hall. As the orchestra plays down below, Villanelle attempts to take Carolyn up on her first season job offer, with one caveat: she no longer wishes to be an assassin. Carolyn all but laughs in Villanelle's face and tells her she's only good for one thing, and if she can't do that, what's the point? Konstantin is still laid up in Scotland, recovering from last episode's massive heart attack, but his shady shenanigans are catching up with him, and time is of the essence. He discharges himself against the doctor's orders, and on his way out, stops by Dasha's bedside, and the two have a quick but polarizing chat about their former pupil. We learn that Dasha's betrayal of Villanelle was apparently attempted murder under the guise of training. Konstantin accuses Dasha of being far too brutal with Villanelle, but Dasha insists she was simply conditioning Villanelle to become the ruthless killer she needed to be. Dasha then calls Konstantin a soft loser with no backbone or ambition. A pissed off Konstantin cruelly tells Dasha she will never return to Mother Russia, she will never see her son again, and she will die alone in this room. He then walks out and leaves her to do just that. Villanelle is at a tea dance, watching couples swing each other around the floor to big band music when Eve walks in. They greet each other kindly but cautiously, and Villanelle breaks the ice by telling Eve this was the location of her first London hit, a high-ranking police officer who happened to be a tango champion. Eve tries to draw her into further conversation, but Villanelle is wistfully staring at the dancers. They look happy and carefree, and Villanelle tells Eve she wants to feel like that. Alarm bells go off in Eve's head, and she persuades her onto the dance floor, and after an awkward yet adorable start, they eventually find their rhythm and fall into each other's arms. While they sway together, Villanelle spies an older couple twirling happily in each other's arms and asks Eve, is that what she wants?
Hell no, to the no, no, no.
Not to mention, she doesn't believe the two of them would last that long. They'd likely consume each other first. Villanelle agrees, but still thinks it would be nice. Then, with regret and perhaps a touch of torment, she tells Eve that she's killed so many people. Just then, 12 Goon and Villanelle wannabe, Rianne, crashes the party. Villanelle quickly gives Eve the slip of paper from Konstantin and sends her on her way, telling her they'll meet up later. After Eve's exit, Rianne gives Villanelle a message. Helene wants to see her. Now. The two assassins are waiting in the subway station when Villanelle begins to antagonize Rianne. Rianne tries to ignore her, but eventually snaps and pushes Villanelle against the wall, which turns out to be a very bad idea. Villanelle then sincerely apologizes to Rianne before giving her a savage beatdown and pushing her onto the subway tracks where she's run over by an approaching car. Geraldine is reading a heartfelt letter to Carolyn, apologizing for all the things she's done that's contributed to their dysfunctional relationship, and Carolyn isn't the least bit interested. When it's her turn to share, she pulls out a blank notebook and tells Geraldine she would very much like it if she left. Geraldine whines and tries to protest, but Carolyn sternly explains that things are coming to a head, and for her own safety, Geraldine must go. Meanwhile, Eve is following the trail of Konstantin's slip of paper, which is actually a betting sheet from a small shop in South London. She has no idea what the numbers written on the sheet mean, but after an embarrassing attempt to bribe the front desk worker, Eve is eventually taken upstairs to meet Bruce, the owner of the betting shop. Bruce finds it hard to believe that a nice lady like Eve is mixed up with a bad guy like Konstantin. But after Eve gives him the crazy eye, he's like, okay, whatever. The numbers on the sheet turn out to be a safe combination, and Bruce points Eve in the direction of the safe it opens. But instead of finding piles of stolen money inside, Eve finds a mysterious package. Carolyn has been summoned to the Bitter Pill offices by her least favorite person, but Jamie insists they've discovered something she needs to see ASAP. Then, Bear tells her about his super convenient secret video camera. Remember in the season's first episode, when we witnessed Kenny secretly munching on Bear's favorite snack, Tangfastics? Apparently, sometime after that, Bear installed a hidden camera to surveil his candy stash. A camera he hadn't bothered to check until the season finale. Turns out the camera not only captured Kenny's candy thievery, but also the entryway into the Bitter Pill offices. And on the day Kenny died, Konstantin paid him a visit, and the two left the office together. Eve has just left the betting shop with Konstantin's loot when she runs into the man himself. Konstantin demands the package, but Eve plays keep away, telling him it's for Villanelle. Konstantin then switches tactics, insisting the package is nothing more than a present for his daughter. And when Eve opens it, she, in fact, finds a Russian nesting doll inside. But when she threatens to throw it into the street, Konstantin finally tells her the truth. There's a barcode printed on the toy that opens yet another safe, this one filled with money and passports. Konstantin is then struck with chest pains and is forced to sit down. Villanelle casually strolls into the Bitter Pill offices, and the gang nearly has a collective heart attack. She then receives a call from Konstantin, demanding that she tell Eve to give him the package. Villanelle refuses. She doesn't trust that Konstantin won't leave without her. He begrudgingly tells her to meet them, but before he can drop a pin on their location, he gets a call from Paul. It seems Paul has discovered that Konstantin's the embezzler and instructs him to come to his house, now. Konstantin agrees, but unfortunately has no idea that Paul is making the phone call under extreme duress. Konstantin arrives at Paul's place with Eve in tow, and we find out the mystery gunman is none other than Carolyn. Moments later, Villanelle shows up, and after exchanging pleasantries with everyone, Carolyn gets down to the matter at hand. Konstantin throws Paul under the bus with a swiftness, telling Carolyn that he's been taking orders directly from Paul. Paul, of course, tells Carolyn he doesn't work for the 12. He's actually been undercover for MI6 this entire time. Konstantin then insists that Paul isn't just working for the 12. He is the 12. Carolyn turns the tables on Konstantin and asks why he killed Kenny. Konstantin denies it, but when Carolyn cocks her gun, he admits to going to the rooftop of the Bitter Pill with Kenny, but not to kill him, to offer him a job. Kenny's investigation was getting too close to the 12, and Paul wanted him dead. Konstantin insists he was trying to save Kenny's life. He tells Carolyn that Kenny became afraid and started backing away, unaware of how close he was to the edge of the rooftop. Konstantin tried to stop him, but Kenny fell. Carolyn coldly tells Konstantin that she doesn't believe him, then instructs him to get on his knees. Eve tries to interject, but Villanelle shushes her as Konstantin begs for his life. He yells at Villanelle to do something, but Villanelle is enjoying the show far too much to stop it. Carolyn is seconds away from killing Konstantin, when she instead turns the gun on Paul and shoots him in the head. She then tells Konstantin to leave before she changes her mind and kills him too. He grabs his loot and asks Villanelle if she's coming with. Villanelle immediately turns him down, telling him he's not family. After Konstantin's departure, Eve questions Carolyn's decision to kill Paul, their only link to the 12. Carolyn tells her that the 12 cannot be destroyed, and maybe it's time for Eve to just let it go. A pissed off Eve storms out, and Carolyn puts in a call to her cleanup guy, Hugh, so they can stage Paul's murder as a suicide. Villanelle catches up to Eve on a bridge overlooking a gorgeous view of the city, and the two finally discuss their relationship without trying to kill each other. Eve admits that she can't imagine her future without Villanelle in it. And Villanelle, in her least psychopathic moment of the entire series, wants to know if she's ruined Eve's life. Is she truly a monster? Eve gently tells her that everyone has their own monsters inside of them, but it's clear to Villanelle that her monster encourages Eve's monster. Eve agrees, even admitting that she wanted it to, but not anymore. Eve then asks Villanelle to help her make it stop.
Now turn around and face the other way.
What?
I'll turn this way.
Now what?
Now we walk.
And that is it for the recap. Thank you guys so much for hanging out with me this season. And be sure to keep an eye out for my upcoming Killing Eve Season 3 review video, where I'll go over my thoughts about the season finale as well as the rest of the season. Plus, I'll let you guys know which show I'll be recapping next. So if you haven't already, don't forget to subscribe, and I'll see you next week.